Thank you. My talk is about the gender in forestry research in Indonesia and how we deal with diversity and complexities. The information in the book says the co-author is only Hasan Toha Adnan, but actually Carol Colfer is also contributing to this presentation. And I would begin with a description of Indonesia. It is a vast and diverse country. I intentionally put the globe here to show the extent, comparison of the extent of the Indonesia compared with other countries. And the land is more than 1.9 million square kilometers, consists of more than 13,000 islands, and the sea is more than 3 million square meters. And population is one of the highest populated countries in the world. This shows the population, more than 237 million in 2010. And depending on how ethnic groups is defined, it's more than 1,100 ethnic groups. Therefore, it also has rich and complex social, cultural, and traditional systems. And in Indonesia, gender mainstreaming instruments has been developed since the late 90s, consists of a series of law and ratification of a convention beginning in 84, presidential instruction, forestry ministerial decree, and followed by decree from other ministries. So in terms of policy, they are there. As mentioned, it began in late 90s or early 2000. However, little progress at national and regional level, indicated by low understanding, high resistance, and weak implementation. And the state of the key stakeholders' knowledge and awareness on gender is relatively poor. Gender is interpreted as about women only or as synonym of women. Let's see some statements. At the central level, the officials often react to their colleagues, their male colleagues who talk about gender. Gender? Ah, you sound like women. Hey, what's wrong? And at district government level, even the head of the district said, in a ceremonial event, he said, "We apologize that only men could attend this event. Gender can't come as they are picking up children from school." Again, gender is women. And this is very recently, head of village said, we know a number of participants should be equal, 15 men and 15 gender. Oops. And in meetings, training, workshops, they are still characterized by men's resistance and debate on women, especially from religious perspectives and traditional norms. And then followed by debate about how gender is different from feminism, or are they the same? And therefore, such meetings, training, workshops have been ineffective to build participants' understanding on the importance of gender-sensitive activities. My presentation, taking lessons from three case studies, as in the previous session, it's from adaptive collaborative management of forests in Jambi. Jambi is in Sumatra. And governance of protected area management under decentralization, Danau Sentarum, West Kalimantan, and linking agroforestry and forestry knowledge with action in South and Southeast Sulawesi. In general, all those case studies or project have the same goal or objective to promote sustainable and equitable forest management among gender and stakeholder groups across levels through learning and participatory approaches. And then the second objective is to look for best mechanism, approach, or tools that can be replicated elsewhere and useful to achieve the first objective. And the main, the umbrella approach is participatory action research. This is the WORM, the learning WORM. And the activities consist of multi-stakeholder processes, capacity building, learning events, and research, which consists of combination, conventional and participatory. And the team main roles is to facilitate and catalyze learning process, but at the same time to observe, document, and analyze the process. Now I would like to talk about, to show the description about the diversity in research sites. In Jambi, in Baru Pelepat village, the ethnic groups consist of Minang descendant, which is matrilineal, Jambi, patrilineal, and migrants from Java, patrilateral tendency, but also some bilateral. And the common property is customary forest. This is the customary forest and protected fish spawning area, part of the river, which is protected and can only be harvested in particular months. Danau Sentarum is in West Kalimantan. Ethnic groups consist of Dayak, in particular Iban, Kantu, and Ambalo. They live communally in longhouses like this. And Malay, they live in individual homes. Both are bilateral. Common property consists of customary forest, fishing area, protected lakes, and forest for wild bee honey. In South Sulawesi, the ethnic groups consist of Makassar, Bugis, and both are patrilineal. Common property is water, community forest, and village forest. There are two. There are so many different associated regulations about the community forest or village forest. And in Southeast Sulawesi, the ethnic groups are more diverse. The indigenous people is Tolaki, bilateral, Bugis, patrilineal, Balinese, migrant, bilateral, Java, patrilineal tendency, but also bilateral, Madurese, patrilineal. And the common property is similar to South Sulawesi, except there is Grand Forest Garden in the area. Now, comparing among the four locations, resistance towards women participation in governance processes, especially in Jambi, is high. It's a bit surprising because the dominant ethnic group there is Minang descendant, which is matrilineal. But high here, I should highlight that high in Indonesia is not as high as in some countries in other regions. In West Kalimantan, low, Southeast Sulawesi low, but South Sulawesi low to medium. Female literacy in Indonesian language, this is one of requirements to be able to participate. The elder people low, youth medium, the same as in West Kalimantan, while in South Sulawesi low. Southeast Sulawesi low to medium. The women's strengths is enthusiasm to participate in Jambi. In West Kalimantan, they're confident to speak in local language. Also in South Sulawesi and Southeast Sulawesi. So main challenge to women's participation is the opposite of the situation in the other three locations. That is women lack of confidence to speak in public. Like we heard also from Nicaragua and Uganda. And another challenge is men resistant. While in West Kalimantan, the main challenge to women participation is that they are not invited. And among the Malay, both men and women think that women's opinion would be well represented by men. For both ethnic groups, language, they don't speak Bahasa Indonesia too well. And remoteness of the area. It's expensive to travel among places there, so if the meeting is only held in one particular location, then there will be difficult to travel. And in South Sulawesi, the challenges are not invited, language, and the meetings are often after dark. Because in the afternoon, they are working in their garden on livelihoods activities, so they prefer meeting after dark. And it's difficult for women to participate. It's dark to come from their house to the meeting place. And the same as in Southeast Sulawesi. And lessons and practical experience from all those studies. This is also our own experience that, but also happened to others. Common mistakes in village participatory meetings. In the first period of the project, we use problem-based approach, identification of problem, and then linear thinking of how to overcome those problems, and then directly communicate it. So if the problem that women doesn't have enough opportunity to participate in meeting, the facilitator directly bring it up into the meeting. Say, that women have rights to be involved in meetings and decision making. They should be allowed to participate. What is the result? Strong reaction and resistance, especially from the customer leaders. And it has led to contradicting outcomes. This is the customer leader. He said, never. From now on, no women are allowed to participate. This is the result of problem-based approach. And there is another general views that often applied directly by facilitators, that women would gain better recognition and voice, leads to equity when they could generate additional income for the family, no matter how hard she has to carrying this fruit in order to get additional income. But what is the fact? It's very, in some cases, have led to economic and physical violence. Husband relies on wife for income, husband's pride threatened, and sometimes manifest in violence. Husband uses wife's money to remarry. This is in particular happened to the wives who work abroad, being workers in neighboring countries. And the last quote came from women. She said, busy wife should be ready if husband wants polygamy. And these negative risks are reported in news and media and directly by communities in our locations, but less reported in scholarly articles than the positive outcomes of that women having additional income. So we need to be careful. And another common mistake is that lack of facilitation skills. Outsiders consist of facilitators, extension workers, project staff, government, act the most knowledgeable person, do not speak local language, and ignore the silence or fail to motivate the silence to speak. A lot of training are based on assumption, generalization, and standard procedure rather than facts. Let's see what are examples of the facts. Objective of training, and therefore the participants' expectation, is about the methods, practical methods to address gender diversity in research, for example. So they expect to learn about the how-to manual. And the second fact is that most of government and local people have learning style called sensing. If you're familiar with the MBTI indicators, introvert, extrovert, sensing, intuitive, thinker, feeler, they are type of sensing, which means they rely on data, details, facts, information that can be understood by the five senses. However, rather than using these facts, the organizers use assumption or overgeneralized views that participants disagree or don't understand yet the importance of gender equity. So this is contradict to the participants' expectation. They have understand, well, in general, okay, gender is important, but how to implement it? But the organizer organized it in different way, so the process always talk about basic concept, principles, theories, and regulations or legal framework. The facts is not used at all to develop the process, and it has resulted in ineffective for most participants. The sensing people wouldn't understand, wouldn't get the message of concept, principle, theories. Rather, they want something real. They want examples. This has contributed to the slow progress for more than 20 years in Indonesia. And meetings always led, trainings always led to resistance and debate again and again. And even this is realized by the participants themselves. They said, we have done this for 20 years and always end up in the same arguments and debate. And it has also created misunderstanding. Too many presentation or discussion on theories, I said, misinterpretation and argument. So they said, the men said, by pushing women attending meetings, you might have reduced children's time with their mother, and it against children's rights. Someone else said, husband and wife have agreed their respective roles. Let's respect, we should not change or interfere. And the harder one, again, the customer leader said, husbands make decisions, wife take care of family at home. It's God's will and defines our. If you say it's bad, you are against God's will. And another common mistakes or common practice is that the government and donor indicators are nominal. For example, number of women participants, the magic number 30%, number of institutions formed, the amount or proportion of budget for gender-related activities. Have they led to equity and better position and conditions of women? We should also think about it, and we should review. And the government or scientific NGO events on gender, most presenters or resource persons or facilitators are women. It happened quite often, and the talk focused on women only. And even in several meetings, the common expression often came up, what do men know about gender? So gender is misinterpreted as women's business only, again leading to debate. Now the question is that what we mean is gender only about women? What are the differences between gender-sensitive programs with feminism movement? Now, back to our experience. What have worked and what are the implications for forestry management? Learning and participatory approaches. We learned that process should meet participants' learning style. If the participants are mostly sensing style, we have to present case studies, practical examples of different impact of policies on men and women rather than theories, concept, regulations. And we also use various facilitation tools that stimulate five senses, including emotions. This is accelerated learning principles. And, reference said that human brain works better to process picture than words, so we avoid too lengthy discussion on using words or wordy presentation. And we learned that if we focus on commonalities and strengths rather than differences and problems, it worked well, worked better. And meetings or workshops should have clear outcomes. For example, common goals, collaborative planning, as well as individual commitment and suggestions on policy or programs. And we also learned that solutions might not be directly related to problems, so linear thinking wouldn't work. And we use strength-based approach, for example, appreciative inquiry. This is also important. Involve men and women equally in gender learning events, not only as participants, but also as resource persons and facilitators. Yet, we often need FGD separately. Otherwise, women often don't want to speak in some cases, like in Jambi. And facilitators should speak local language to help translate and understand local culture. As a conclusion, gender in forestry is not only about women. It's about the dynamic interaction between men and women. And the context is site and time specific. Therefore, there is no one-size-fits-all approach or method. And if our team experienced using learning and organizational development theories and tools, and we found it quite useful in terms of make some social changes. And this is, I would close this presentation with quote from our field facilitator, who is a man, Ardila Barani, and also another colleague from ICRAF. They said, promoting gender equity should not overload women. If women are facilitated to take more roles and have better access to decision making in natural resources management and land use planning, men should also be facilitated to be willing to take over some domestic activities. Thank you.